Next, we have Superintendent Feeney. There's some issues dealing with the sidewalks, and he also has his fiscal year 2017 budget request. Do you want to start with the budget, Ken? Starting with highway?
We're going to start with highway, yep.
Okay.
Everybody on highway?
Yep.
Okay. What we've got is, under the payroll, we're looking for some summer help.
Okay.
And we're looking for some overtime. This budget was cut last year. I'm thinking that it was, I know at the town meeting, Mike, the warrant committee said that it was, you know, we took an extra guy, we asked for a new guy, and we took it out. And that was the explanation, so I had taken. I thought maybe that's what happened, is I took it out, and then warrant committee memo to Joy, and I think we took overtime out. And so we're basically just looking to put the money back in. Total sum is $45,000. I've given the finance committee a number of options on that, three summer help, and then overtime increases, so that they can review that. And it reflects really on the overall budget is 3.6. Mm-hmm. So in the spirit of the warrant committee doing 2.5, but it's there. So that's where we're at on the highway budget.
It looks like, Ken, if I'm reading this correct, the difference last year was longevity that is not in this year?
Yeah, longevity every year changes, yeah, because you've got a lot of young kids now down there, and they get longevity. After 5 years, they get it.
Yep. Okay.
All right.
Hey, Mark or Pete, questions on highway?
Ken, you've got a lot of things that are coming out this year, like resurfacing the subdivisions?
Yes.
Why are we taking that out? Don't we want to keep up with that?
Subdivisions is under capital budget. We have $40,000 in the account for redoing subdivisions. I think we did on this budget here, the asphalt remains the same. We'll do the same amount in the subdivision resurfacing program that we have done every year. We're not cutting anything out of there.
So that's under capital budget?
It's under, well, there is one capital item for $40,000, but that wouldn't be enough to do the subdivisions anyway.
Mm-hmm.
But that subsidizes it, but we do take it right out of this budget here.
Mm-hmm. So I'm looking at the last page of the highway.
Okay, yeah.
And there are like half a dozen or eight items there that just you're saying you're not funding this year?
No.
Resurface subdivision, $37,000, and again, resurface subdivision, $40,000. Storm, I don't know what it's, stormwater something, for $11,000 that's not getting funded. Resurface subdivision again.
Yeah, these budgets were, they were zeros anyway. They were, what I've got on that page there is that's expended. The first column was expended last year in those line items. But basically it does, what it comes out of is highway materials, mm-hmm. which is a total of $300,106.
Mm-hmm.
So all those line items were in there at one time, but, you know, so it's actually under highway materials, $300,000.
So those have moved to highway materials?
Yes.
But that $300,000 was there as well last year, right, for highway materials?
Hmm?
I'm looking at the highway materials, the line for that. It says that there was $300,000 for that
yes.
last year, and you're asking for $300,000 for that this year.
Yep.
So I guess I'm still not understanding where these six or eight items have gone to, if we're just spending less money or what we're doing.
There were zeros. I think if you can look at gasoline was zero last year. It's just they were charged, other equipment. There was little things that the secretary looks at the highway budget and looks at we look at the bottom line, you know, the balance at the bottom line. But there used to be line items there, and they're just not there anymore. I think when we converted over to Munis, we lost a lot of those line items. But we didn't zero them. We did spend money in them under those categories, but that's just for the reference, like other equipment. I could see that utility electricity.
Mm-hmm.
We used to have electricity in our highway budget for the garage, but then we broke it out into a utility budget. So that's why it's, but she did charge it. This is telling me with if we're charging electricity to the highway budget, we came up short in some of the other ones.
I'm confused also then, where it says zero, then you're just saying they've been reassigned to different areas?
Yeah. Yes. Yep.
Is it a question of when the money is budgeted, can you budget it under highway materials, which covers a whole list of things?
Yes.
And it's spent during the year, the accountant puts it back into the subdivided categories. So I think what you're probably, you're probably looking at the expended funds from last year, which get broken down. So it's budgeted, I believe it gets budgeted in highway materials, which gives some flexibility in how it's spent. But that's what was spent, because if you look last year, because if you're looking at this last page, all of the budget and the expenditures, they match exactly.
Yeah.
Which even in as well-run a town as this, doesn't always happen. And so I think last year, this all would have been, when we looked at the budget, would have come under highway materials, and then they get slotted as they get spent out, because you might spend $42,000 on asphalt one year and $38,000 on something else. You can't always project what's going to be needed from the highway materials standpoint.
Right.
I think that's how we understand, at least from the work with the standpoint, we understand the way this budget is put. I'm sure Michael and Ken would correct me, but I think that's the distinction. What you're looking at being what was expended, but when it was actually budgeted, it was budgeted for highway material.
Yeah.
So Ken, that would imply that you're double counting the materials, because it has on the sheet that the current budget is $1,511,848. But then on your front sheet, you got your total appropriation of $1,261,092.
Well, that's last year, $1,261.
Right. Yeah, I think this is the way
this year is
$1,313. Right. Yeah.
But for your current budget, you have $1,511,000.
No, here's the $1,286,222.
Here he's got the.
Now, that's his request for next
right,
year.
But this is last year.
No. That was projected, that's the request.
And see, the last year amount doesn't correspond.
From last year?
Yeah, I think it's just the way the input was done on the computer system. Is really what it is.
Yeah.
Because you're right, because what it is, the highway materials, when they allocated them out, they didn't net them out of the top original budget line.
That's what I think.
Yeah.
The input isn't right on this system. You can see how it got allocated now.
Yeah, so I think you're double counting that $300,000 once under the highway materials and once on this last page.
This printout, yeah.
Right.
On the
yes.
detail printout, exactly.
So you're saying the actual appropriation last year was $1,261,092.
Yeah, that was the appropriation last year, yes.
Okay.
Yeah. That makes sense.
Yeah, it's a little confusing because it looks like when you get to this page, it's $1,511,000.
But it isn't.
But I think it's because it's double counted.
Yeah.
Thank you.
We can go over that and see if there's some way that we can come up with a way that ties in better.
Yeah.
You know, you might want to zero out the 300,000 if you're spreading it out among these other items.
Yeah, I think that's just the way it went into Munis, Mike. I think it eliminated a lot of line items, but when the
probably
secretary
Munis
sits there and does
their
stuff,
and it's probably it's probably an adjustment to the Munis system you got to make to tie in with your appropriation. Okay.
That does happen in other budgets too.
Oh, it has. So
you get that last sheet,
yeah,
the printout of what was spent last year.
Yeah,
it doesn't always line up with the way.
Yeah.
The budget is done.
Yeah.
The different departments don't always break them down precisely for the category.
To the dollar amount, yeah.
Yeah.
Anything else on highway? Okay, thanks, Ken. Next.
Okay, that went smoothly.
Ah, snow and ice, what a lovely topic.
Yes, snow and ice is good.
Timely.
Again, snow and ice is, we never appropriate enough money. But we do go up on it once in a while.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just offering it to the Finance Committee if they want to increase it by 10% so that we don't run out of money at Christmas. You know, it's kind of like a little embarrassing.
I know, because it's
we're doing good this year. We're doing well this year so far. And last time I listened to the weather, I think it was 2 feet of snow coming in. And that's
But your projection
on the
is
weekend,
always
naturally.
It always snows on Martin Luther King Day.
Yep. It was. You were laughing at me on Friday, weren't you?
Yes. We did, we were able to cover last year's snow deficit in 1 year, so we won't have any carryover till next year, which is great, thanks to the warrant committee transferred $50,000 from their reserve fund. And then I had estimated $200,000, my tax rate estimate, and we got $93,000 from the state aid. So the, excuse me, not state aid, federal aid.
Right, they declared, an emergency on one of the storms, yeah.
On the, just on the first storm.
$93,000.
Now, I meant to ask our reps, I should check with them. The governor supposedly put $25 million in his budget to assist cities and towns with snow removal costs, but we've never heard anything more on that. So I don't know whether it got cut out or what. That was going to be about, the first figure I saw was about $45,000 for the town, but.
I heard that too, that's where I thought it was coming from. Can you follow up on that?
Yeah.
You made a lot of publicity with that.
Yes, yeah. And then when the publicity came through about the money, it was just the federal money that got distributed, nothing about state money, so it probably fell by the wayside with the, maybe that was our 9C cut.
Ken, it seems not only snow and ice, but some of the other ones that we have an increase in the equipment repair. Are we at a stage that a lot of our equipment is going to be needing additional repair? It seems, like, for example, on the snow and ice went from $30,000 up to $60,000, and it was true on some of the other budgets as well.
Right. Yeah, our equipment has taken a beat in the last 2 years in snow and ice. And matter of fact, if you go down there right now, it's full of snow equipment, the three mechanics bays. We've been, a lot of these things, remember, were parked because of the construction of the highway garage. They were parked outside. And the other thing is that now we have police and the fire department moved into the garage. We're still outside. Mm-hmm. So this is going to be 2 years, two winches outside. So it's going to be a little thick at all. It'll take a
while.
Yeah.
It's just an observation. So the contracted snow plowing has really gone down a lot. From when I was a kid in Medfield, it seemed like the town used more of the local, you know what I mean, builders and stuff would plow. So it's more of the town equipment now, I guess.
Yeah, a lot of the small contractors retired.
And, yeah, that's my kind of.
And, you know, it's kind of that we always had to all small local contractors. We could hire three trucks right now. That's it.
Yeah.
But we have our own equipment.
Good equipment now, yeah.
And we utilize retired personnel to plow snow for us, which I call them the cheap help.
Yeah.
You know, so it works out pretty good for us. And, again, we're non-union, and we can do that.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
So it's a good deal for the town.
Yeah. Just because when we grew up, it was always Mr. Callow. We'd always do all our neighborhood, of course, because we lived in Summer Street, so it was just, you'd just be around the corner and stuff like that. So for 20 years.
But, you know, it's expensive for them to keep the trucks on the road
in
the winter.
Sure is, yeah.
It's really expensive. It's the state taxes on their trucks. It's crazy. Yeah.
The other thing that Ken has pointed out on that, too, is he's now competing with the malls and the shopping centers and the office buildings, you know, and it's much easier to plow a parking lot. It's just one big rectangular area than it is to a road where you worry about knocking people's mailboxes over and people chasing you down the street with shovels and that sort of thing. So
we only pay $65 an hour for a 10-wheeler. We're low. You can do a survey right around here. Everybody's up high. The difference is with the other towns, municipalities, and the state. If you go to the state, you're going to wait a long time to get your money. Medfield pays every 7 days. So that's why these guys, the small guys, like to work for us for the $65 an hour instead of the 95 over in Walpole, you know.
And waiting, and then waiting forever and ever.
Wait for it, yeah.
Okay, anything else on snow and ice?
Okay, this budget actually went down. Okay. I think we reduced some of the fuel costs.
No, it's in your salaries.
The salaries went, yes, yeah.
Well, because the actual equipment repair actually went up from 143 to 173. But
right, the equipment went up, but the overall budget's minus one.
Mm-hmm. Your gasoline now went down quite a bit. Is that reflecting the downward trend of the cost of
gas? Yeah.
Do we have our own pump up and working at the station?
the garage?
Yeah, we have diesel, we have two. We have diesel and we have gasoline.
Working now, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Okay.
And do the police and fire and council on aging and those, do they all use that now, or?
Yeah, all the town departments do, yeah.
Everybody's on it, yeah.
We're no longer using Irving or?
No, no, no. We're in a contract. See, the difference is, we're in a contract, okay? We have a contract with the Norfolk County, there's multiple towns that are in that contract. You still gotta, you order fuel, you gotta consume that fuel under the old contract. So if gas prices right now dropped. Now, our contracts will start up again in September with the new contract, which is lower. Okay, so sometimes, you know, it doesn't look right, but it is. It's, you know, you gotta finish, you know, when you sign the contract, you gotta finish the fuel that you were signed on board for. And the problem we had was fuel went down and we were locked into an old contract because remember, we were building the highway garage, we didn't have any gas. So we didn't use, consume the contract. And so we got stuck with some high gasoline prices when the gas dropped because we had to finish off the contract, so that's.
Well, so you contract out X gallons of gas or diesel fuel in a specific.
That's correct.
It's not a time, but it's volume.
Right.
That's what you contract.
And then it's, then when they bid it, now this one here is gonna have a, it has a flex in the contract. And it, because they don't know where the price is really going either, but they put a flex in it that's, it can go up or down, like 56 cents, I think, in some cases, you know, so it can go either way.
Yeah.
So it's kinda.
So then, Ken, the equipment repair increase again would be your same answer, that because of the different equipment that has to be outdoors and after a rough winter last year, that's, that is reflecting that increase?
Yeah, with the equipment budget is pretty much always in trouble, you know, as far as the equipment goes. So, yeah, I think that's justified for the equipment. And I think that, you know, again, the overall budget's minus one, so I just, you know.
So, Ken, I was coming out of the Highway Garage conference room 9:30 last Wednesday. I think it was the State Hospital Master Planning Committee meeting. And one of the police officers was filling up a cruiser at the gas pumps. And all of a sudden it dawned on me, I have no clue how you monitor who fills up there.
He's got an electronic key.
Okay, so everybody just has to.
Identifies the crew. I don't know how the chief set his up. It's all it is just a little thing that swats. If mine swats, it's Ken Feeney. You know, and gasoline.
Ken does so much gas on this day, yeah.
And so, but I don't know if he identifies the patrolman or if he just identifies the cruiser. I think he identifies the cruiser. But I mean, you know, we consume 30,000 gallons of gas a year.
Yeah.
30,000 gallons of diesel a year. So I mean,
and we're confident that nobody's taking gas that they shouldn't be taking for their own personal vehicles.
There's cameras on that gas pump.
Oh, cameras.
Yeah.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
Okay. Next.
Sidewalks is a small budget. It's usually for the repairs of existing sidewalks. Okay. It's not for extending sidewalks. It has been used for that in the past, if it's any money left over in it. But it's to upgrade the existing sidewalks and, you know, repair them. A lot of it's spent in the subdivisions. You know, when we go into the subdivisions to do the stone seal, we upgrade the sidewalks along those lines. And so made it an independent budget, you know, because I think it's important to have it stand out there by itself. And we're asking for a $10,000 increase. We're going from $30,000 to $40,000, which is not number-wise probably outrageous. But it's it reflects a 33% increase because it's such a small budget.
But this doesn't count any additional. This would be repair of existing, correct?
Existing, yes.
Ken, have the asphalt prices dropped much? Or is that, are we still in the middle of a bid situation?
Funny thing about that, you know, when the federal government did that bailout with asphalt, we got nothing out of it, and except high gas asphalt prices. It has corrected again. It's gone down, but we took a beating. We took a real beating. We took about a $20 a ton beating for prices of asphalt when the federal government released all that money to put on the roads. I think it's a classic case of the federal government just being a bull in a china shop. But anyway, that's just my feelings. We saw nothing from that bailout, and we. ended up with higher asphalt.
We put a lot of asphalt out this past year.
Yeah.
Was that unusual? Is that accumulation?
No, that's you know, that reflects the I mean, we had to bring in, we had to hire a grinder. Our grinder was too small. We brought in a 4-foot wide grinder and private contractor. And that way there, we were actually putting out, we were doing pretty good. I think one day we actually got 100 ton out. And so we can put quite a bit of asphalt out once you get a private contractor in there grinding.
Yeah.
It was only in about 3 days, and it gave the highway department like a week and a half of work.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's just, you know, it's really a lot.
Yeah.
This year here, I think we plan on, we're looking at a 4-foot grinder for our front end loader to put on there, because we wouldn't have to hire him. I think we paid about $9,000 for, like, you know, for 3 days or something like that, or 4 days maybe, but it was a lot of money. So we feel as though a $30,000 grinder can pay for itself in one season, you know. It's just really, so that's the way we go. You know, you grind it in any of the weak spots, alligator cracks, anything like that, grind them out, and that's what we do. So, you know, they gave us big equipment, and got to keep it busy.
Is that something it's possible to regionalize at all, if you had a grinder to share with another town? Or?
It's a funny thing is everybody does asphalt at the same time. That would be kind of a, I think that we, I can remember back on a street sweeper that was regionalized with Medway and Millis.
Mm-hmm.
And it didn't work out, I don't think, very well, because obviously come spring, both towns wanted it. And then one town would hand it to the other town, and something was broke. You know what I mean? And, you know, it just, who's paying this and that? You know, it just wasn't ending. You know what I mean? It was a good idea, I guess. I knew it wouldn't work, you know, and it didn't. But, you know, because I spoke to the superintendents at the time, Medway and Millis, and, you know, it wasn't working out.
So something like a grinder like that, you would not recommend?
Yeah. We did go a large roller one time, okay? Norfolk had a large roller. And why a town would buy a large roller, I mean, this is a pretty good-sized roller, but it had problems, had to be repaired. So we had a what we called a highway workshop way back then, and we used to meet on a monthly basis. Well, we got together with, like, three towns, and we fixed that roller, and therefore then we shared that roller. But you don't need a big roller like that in everyday operations. It's just, right. You know, it's just right. Not. It's something. We also bought a screening machine. But we don't need a screening machine every day, and they're very expensive. So we bought it with 10 other towns. And we had that. That was a regionalization. Then we got out of that, and we just went with Westwood for a partner on the one we have now. It's a bigger machine. That there was a bankruptcy, and we got involved in that, and Westwood and Medfield bought a screening machine, which we have now. The thing is 99% of the time in Medfield, but it's because Westwood hasn't got a place to park it, and they don't have a place to store their materials. They don't have a compost operation like we have, because they don't have the land.
Yep, yep, yep.
And
So that's worked out then.
Yeah. So it's worked out well for us, yes.
Okay. Anything else with sidewalks? We have a lot of other sidewalk issues, but with the budget, anything else in the budget? Okay, next, Ken.
Public Works Utilities.
All right.
Reflects a 1% increase.
Might just be helpful to give the numbers, since people at home don't have the numbers. It's projected at 97,000.
Yeah, and it's split almost 50. Well, the bulk of it is electricity, at least 42,000.
Yep, 42,000. That's level funded.
Yeah.
Where is that from? The electricity covering what?
Town garage.
Just
town
the town
garage electricity. Yes. Yeah.
And then the solid waste is the electricity for the solid waste.
Now we're projecting to put solar panels onto the town garage. Am I correct in that?
Yeah, if we have enough money left over from the wastewater treatment plant, we're hoping to be able to. Now, we have an article on town meeting to do that, to transfer the funds from the unexpended balance. how quickly that could be done, you know, it's questionable. I talked to Andrew today, and he said they're almost finished with the treatment plant solar operation. He said they're finishing up on the electricity and they just have a few more things to do.
He's looking to turn it on February 11.
Right. It's his birthday.
It's his birthday.
He says, that Lincoln's birthday? And he said, no, it's mine.
So hopefully if we get the solar panels, that would be able to reduce that amount in the future years.
How do these figures compare to the Old Town Garage? Any idea? Are they, you know, is it costing a lot more for the utilities?
Oh, yeah, I'd say a little bit. Not significantly more. Really not.
It's not really.
You know, it's all motion lights down there. It's nobody in the room. Lights don't come on.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. And even if we're in there for a snowstorm, where are they? They're on the road. So all the lights, kind of basically all the lights are out.
Yeah.
You know, maybe the crew room might have the lights on, but that's about it, and the mechanic space.
And then on your gas, is that working out with all the doors in there? Are they pretty good now that it's getting cold about keeping the doors down when they leave?
Yeah.
You know, in the summer, it doesn't matter because in our air conditioning, there was a lot of, they were leaving the doors open a lot, which probably makes sense. But I assume now they're putting them down.
Well, it's a much tighter building, yeah. Yeah, the doors, yeah, but they have a remote control in the truck. So every truck is assigned to a bay, certain bays, and they have that bay, and they open the door, they go out, and they close the door behind them with the remote control. So that's the way that works.
And the doors, I know they were having some problems with the doors not operating correctly. Has that been fixed?
So far, yeah, it's worked. They're working now. All of them are working now, and we had, I think we actually had a recall on the pulley system on them, and they replaced them. It was just a bad batch that came out, and it was just, we ended up with the whole run, you know.
So they've all been replaced now?
They replaced them, yeah. Good. They replaced them, and I think they're beyond their warranty now.
Good.
Yeah. So, Ken, I know that when the garage first opened, I noticed that lights were on at night down there, and Mike told me that there were problems with birds setting off the motion sensors or something.
Yeah, we removed the motion detectors from the mechanics bay. We went over to manual now. They shut them on, turn them on manual, and shut them off.
So the lights should be shut off in the garage at night. So if I see lights on, should I be calling somebody? Because occasionally I see lights on down there.
Yeah, it shouldn't be, not unless it's, you remember you got the fire department living there too. So what they're doing,
that's right. I don't know where they are.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, Mike. Yeah.
So
is there any security lighting that's left on all night down there?
Well, the security lighting outside the building, yes.
Outside the building.
Yeah.
So
the lights I've seen have been in the bays.
Oh, yeah.
That was in the mechanics bay, yeah.
With the fire department in there, how much of your equipment has to be outside because of their being in?
The fire department in there?
Yeah, because of their being in what would otherwise be your spaces. How much of your stuff is?
Oh, I think we got, we have a bunch down. We park them down the sewer station. But we're now bringing stuff back up. All our plows are outside, okay? All the plows. It's kind of a little bit tough on those. So it's, it is what it is.
Is that in there where all the plows be?
Oh, yeah, everything goes. Yeah, everything goes in. Yeah, yeah.
And when you're saying plows, you're referring to the actual plow itself, not the vehicle. Because I saw the plows were all lined up outside.
Yeah, they are out. Yeah, but we're going to have those inside.
Are they still putting them on outside? Because that's a headache to put them on outside.
Well, no, we'll put them on in.
Bring them in to put them on?
Well, and not only that, on the big trucks, you can leave the plow on, if you want, in the bay. Because that's the way they were designed. Those bays are designed to have the trucks in the bay with the plows on. Okay, so. But we will be taking them off. And the reason is, the sanders, we have underslung plows, the small plows, and so the sanders can go quicker with the underslung plow at the beginning of a storm and get the chemical on the road.
Yeah.
Okay, that's the purpose. If you look under the sanders, they got a plow underneath them.
Right.
And so they can move much faster and put more material out without having a big plow on the front.
Yeah.
But then when the snow gets, if the snow starts to get deep, we have to put the big plows on them, you know.
Okay, next.
All right.
Dropping like a rock. Look at that.
Yep.
Yeah.
We had to redo the tipping fee on this one here. because of our new contract with recycling and anticipated increases in tipping at Millbury. But right now, what we do is our recycling trips, we make 14 hauls a month.
Okay.
And then, and pretty simple math, times 12 is 168 hauls.
Yeah.
So you get the 168 hauls, and Mike and I used the average of the next haul price of, I think that was 163.
Yeah.
So that's how you get your 27,384 for the hauling. And then we said 1,000 tons of recycling, 21, the tip fee, $21 per ton.
Yeah.
That's an average we figure for the next 3 years, and that's $21,000. We have to rent the containers under the new contract, and that's $1,800 rental a year. And then Wheelabrator, we get it at $67 a ton, 3,000 tons of trash, $201. Total of $251,184. Okay, and this is actually down about 0.5%, this whole budget overall.
Yep. Any questions on solid waste?
One thing to point out, there is an article that the, I have to think of the name now, Transfer Station Recycling Committee asked to put on. It's to set up a 53.5 revolving account, one of those funds that they have at the beginning. And they're looking for $10,000 to be from fees or donations that they collect during the course of the year. So I assume, Ken, what fees do they collect? Is this, if there's a mattress collection program or something, those, I assume those?
No, we don't get, we don't, no. We get, what they did is at the end of the year, they had a company come in and clean out the swap area completely, mm-hmm. okay, on the last day. And that company paid them some money. And I don't know how much it was exactly. I don't recall how much money. Not a big check or anything like that, but it's just they're puzzled on how they what they want to do with it.
Is that the one that was 5 cents a pound for one and a penny a pound for another or something?
Something like I think. But I don't know if they got, did they get 1,500, Mike? I'm not too sure.
I don't know, but they're asking for $10,000, so they may be looking for some other types of fees or donate. They may be asking people to contribute to, you know.
And what were they going to do with the $10,000?
It's just a place. They would like to have some money to do things to improve the swap area primarily, I think so.
Yeah.
I think it's a good idea to give them a little bit of their own source of funding rather.
So are they looking for an appropriation of $10,000 or they're anticipating
no.
that they'll get $10,000 in fees and other things?
Yeah, the hope, yes. They're anticipating that they'd get that, and that would be deposited in this fund rather than go in the general
fund. Could hold is capped at $10,000, is that the idea?
Well, they don't really know how much they're going to get.
Yeah,
you know, they. I think it's just kind of a guess at this stage. It's like several of the others, you know. The respite care program started out at 30,000, then went to 75, and now they're looking for 125,000. Some of the others, the Hold Steady, the ambulance fee, and the other one that's taken a big jump is the what do they call it? Advanced life life support for the ALS. That's gone up quite a bit. As the number of ambulance runs has increased. So. But that doesn't come out of property tax. It comes out of other fees they collect. So.
Okay. Anything else? Okay, next, Ken.
On trees.
That on the solid waste, Pete, following up on your suggestion, might be good to, because it's not that often we have budgets that go down. But the budget request for solid waste is the appropriation this year is $590,275.
That's down about 0.5%.
And the request is $569,416. So that's about a little over $20,000 that's going down.
Yeah.
So.
Yep.
Okay, trees.
Trees. We're up 2%.
Yeah.
And I think what have we got here? Why are we up 2%?
It's just your contract service, right?
Yeah.
Tree company.
Yeah.
And you've got any type of editing or improvement to plan.
Yeah.
And Ken, is there a line item of actual tree plantings, the number of trees to be planted?
No, I don't think so.
Well, I see tree supplies. I'm not sure what that is.
That could be a chainsaw, something like that. You know what I mean? It could be. I mean, we have bought trees out of this budget, you know, and planted trees. So, I mean, but it's not. In fact, I don't know. How do we, was that part of the GECO trees over across the street? Did we buy those last year?
Well, we had money appropriated by Brothers Mark, and then that money went to the
police. It went to police department for the traffic lights. So we did spend it with the expectation of getting reimbursed, but instead being reimbursed, which would have been the general fund because it was after the close of the year, but instead we used it for the traffic light replacement or upgrade.
You know, when we met, Ed was going to come up with kind of a proposal of different places where trees could be planted, and we could kind of look at that. Do you know if he was able to do that?
We have, as a matter of fact, the cemetery, we did have some, quite a few trees over the cemetery. Lost quite a few over the cemetery. It's just, you know, old age, but.
Either roadside trees or in downtown or anything, is there any?
They're putting quite a few trees in with the public safety building along Dale Street, and so there'll be quite a few going in there, yeah.
The grant we got from Eversource, no?
Yes, all the plantings at the Public Works facility came from Eversource.
That was all from Eversource.
That's Town Garage. We're talking about public safety. As part of the project, the public safety building, they'll be putting.
Their budget?
Yep.
Yeah.
And then where else are we putting trees? Someplace. Oh, we're putting a few in out back here as part of this parking lot to replace the trees that have been taken down. Are you putting any on Metacomet when you do that sidewalk, Ken?
No.
No?
No.
Sometimes the people don't want them, you know.
Well, you know, it's right now we got to move the telephone poles back, so it's on Metacomet.
Oh, the telephone poles are on
trees,
that side.
You don't plant trees under the wires.
Yeah, that's true.
Because
yeah.
Once they become, you know, the people like them, they have to head. Eversource comes along and cuts the top off them, you know.
Yeah.
So.
I guess it just was my hope that we had a kind of a game plan or a master plan on the trees, and we could appropriate money so that down the road, ongoing, when the tree dies, it's going to be replaced, or we look around and we say, you know, here's a spot that we can have a tree, and we'd have kind of a plan of where we're going to go with that.
Well, I think Eddie's plan was when he got together with the planning board and the subdivision rules and regulations make them, the developers, plant trees in their subdivisions. I think just on Rockwood over there on off of Dale Street.
Yeah, no, I think that's great.
I think there might be 40 trees in there.
Wow.
You know, because they have to be so far apart.
And that's part of the rules and regulations now, right?
Yeah.
I was more thinking in the downtown area. Maybe this, hopefully you'll be able to go to the downtown summit that they're going to have on February the 9th, is it?
Mm-hmm. I'm not sure the date is around.
It's going to be over at the library. I believe it's the 9th to look at, you know, the whole downtown. I think tree planting and other things would be a factor of that. So hopefully
you got to be, you know, when you do them, you got to be careful about the roots and lifting the sidewalks up. You know, again, when they become a nice tree,
right,
they're a nuisance. I think the locusts across the street over here that they planted, they weren't done right.
It's important to do the right thing. I'm amazed that if you look at Maple Street, all their trees are planted in between the sidewalk and the street. There's hundreds of them that are in there. So it must be certain trees are better to plant so that the roots don't come up versus others who are notorious.
Yeah, the Bradford pears, Norwood put a whole bunch out, and they put them on the grass strip, and I laughed because I didn't think that with the salt that Norwood puts out, I didn't think they were going to last. They're beautiful. They went right up.
They're
there.
A good street tree, actually. Cause
and you know what? They didn't lift the sidewalks.
They have them in Newtonville, right along in the downtown, actually, and they seem to be doing fine. I mean, there's not a bit of dirt in sight.
I think they're pretty hardy, and they're actually kind of tight a little bit too. You know, they don't go.
They call them right here.
So they're probably a pretty good sidewalk tree. You know.
Right. Yeah. You don't want to crowd out the whole sidewalk.
Yeah, right, yeah.
Yeah, at least.
And the other ones you don't put are the fruit trees, you know, the cherries and stuff like that, because they lose leaves in the winter. You're going to knock somebody's eye out because they have that umbrella.
And they're messy, and when they bear fruit too, and the fruit drops, they can stain your sidewalks.
Yep, he does that too.
I think these trees, ginkgo trees, they need to be trimmed too, because otherwise they get very skinny and columnar, so they have to be trained a little bit, so.
Well, I think the other thing is, as we plant them, especially the first couple of years, you have to make sure they're well watered as well, which is an extra burden. You know, they have those bags that go around, although somebody said the water doesn't actually stay in there a long period of time. It's only a matter of hours.
No, it doesn't, yeah, it doesn't. They will go right out.
I thought they were
going for
like weeks.
Yeah.
Eddie was watering those every day, wasn't he?
Eddie was watering them early in the morning because, you know, he had to get over there before the parking. Anybody was parking in front of the store.
Yeah.
And he was over there early in the morning. Eddie did a good job. He watered everything down the Public Works Department, everything. So he did a good job.
So if there are trees we planted, then there's nothing in this budget. Where would that come from? Just somewhere within the budget?
Yeah. Yeah, we'd have to just figure, you know, how many trees you want, or you'd have to, you know, have Eddie figure it out, price the trees, you know, that kind of, whatever type of trees are going to be. But again, we were over the cemetery for quite a bit, quite a few. The subdivisions really have a lot of trees planted.
The developer does them,
yes.
And then, so you think it's better than having my question is a line item that would be for tree planting?
You know, it's, I mean, you can have a line item for tree planting if you want, but, you know, it's kind of funny is the trees that Eddie's taken down right now, a lot of pines died, you know, and it's just, obviously the Dutch elm and the rest of them that he's taken down is, and often, more often than not, there's really not a place to, you know, kind of put them in. They kind of grew there wild, and maybe that's why they died, because it's, you know, road salt, whatever, or just old age. And, you know, I did ask Eddie that, because I'm saying, geez, it seems like, you know, we're losing a lot of trees here, and it's just, it's that their age, it was just the age of the trees. It's just, that's it. They're going to...
Is it like when he took down one at Lowell Mason and North Street, which is a dead tree? I would think that might be a good spot to replant one, you know, in that.
Yeah,
place.
Yeah.
Okay.
We could see.
So I had someone come to my office hours last month talking about, and it just happened, it was a different issue. They live next to the FAF Center, and it's the people that asked us to consider cutting the trees there. They've actually offered to plant better trees, in their mind, I guess, than the ones that are there. And I told them to take that up with Eddie. That would be his call, I would think.
Yeah, Eddie's not, you know, trees that are healthy and exist, he's not the type of guy that takes them down for any kind of a swap, you know.
All right, I didn't know that, so I just
yeah, he's just,
told
he's
him
adamant
to get in
about
touch
it.
With Eddie.
If Eddie takes a tree down, it's had it. You know, we're actually having a tree hearing right on the corner of Dale and Adams Street. That oak tree, I think it is. Yeah, that huge one. Yeah, it's hollow. It's got to come down. But it's partially alive, so Eddie felt as though a tree here would be appropriate. You know, so. Yeah, it's a big one.
Oh, that's a big tree.
It's a big one, yeah. Then we got one big pine, real big pine, down on Nebo Street, down by Mike, that has to come down. That one's dead. So.
I know there were a couple. It looks like you marked them. I had sent you a thing on... Noon Hill Road, another one by Noon Hill and Causeway. Looks like somebody X'd them. Looks like they're ready to come
yeah.
I mean, those are huge.
Yeah.
And they come down, they're going to go clear. I mean, across roads and everything.
Well, that's the problem, yeah. And they knock out the power and everything else. So it's, you know, you got to keep up with them.
Okay. Yeah. Anything else on trees?
No. Eddie Hinckley does a good job.
Just again, the tree budget request is $65,326.
That's up from 64,126. Next, Ken.
Water Department.
Oh, no, you got cemetery.
Oh, cemetery, okay. And the cemetery, here it is. One more.
175,000 last year, 174,400 this year.
That's salaries. The reduction is in salaries. We had two employees move on down there that were making higher money, and we brought in two employees which are making lower wages.
Okay.
So that's your reduction. And so it's minus 6%.
Anything else, Cemetery? Okay, thank you.
Ken, how are you doing on the columbarium sales? Are they selling, or have you sold many?
I think we've sold four, Mike.
Four? Good.
Yeah, I think so.
You have, what, 96?
I think we got 96, yeah.
That's not bad. You don't want to sell them too fast, then you got to build more.
One guy bought two, I think, for him and his wife and his son. He bought two. And but then we just had one. We just had actually a ceremony down there for the ashes.
Yeah.
Okay. Water?
Water department.
829 last year, 829,000, 875,000 this year.
I think last year we got a little bit overzealous with the cuts in the water and the sewer, but Water and Sewer Board has voted these. They reviewed them and voted them at their meeting, and they support the budget as presented.
Ken, your salaries are down by about $8,000, so it's your operations account that's gone up?
Yeah.
What areas in the operations are going up?
You see, we went up in electricity, Mike.
And that'll be coming back down, so that's good.
Yep.
Come down to zero.
Where else have we gone up? Not much.
Looks like mostly electricity.
Yeah, it looks like it, yeah. And contract services for water went up a little bit.
And the supplies, right, just a little bit.
Yeah, well, see, and you also have a column there what we did spend. We spent 110, we're only going up to 70,000.
Right.
So contract services is big.
Good.
Yeah.
And how's the overall just state of the quality of our water? Any other issues with that?
No. Other than down at wells 3 and 4, we do have a manganese problem that right now we're in a design stage for a treatment plant down there.
Wasn't there an article on that?
Yeah. There's 150,000 this year and 150,000 next year for the design of a manganese iron treatment facility, whatever form that takes.
The other thing, Ken, John Haney, which I had not heard of, I just mentioned, I don't know if you heard, that the town of Medway is buying from the town of Millis a huge amount of water. They're going to pull out from the aquifer. I take it Millis Aquifer is the Charles River Aquifer.
It is, yep.
Which is, of course, upstream from us. If they're pulling that amount of water out, is that anything we should be worried about or concerned about?
No, our drawdowns this year were good. I don't know when they started drawing. I don't know.
Well, they haven't yet, but they will be.
Okay.
Yeah.
Usually I get a notice on that when there's going to be an increase in the water. So they must be already permitted for it.
How are they going to be able to do that with the restrictions? You know, we can only withdraw so much water. How are they getting permission to increase their withdrawals?
Well, I would get a notice on that, Mike, if they were. I got a notice from the town of Canton that they wanted to increase their pumping. And, a public notice to go to a public hearing. So I'm the local water resource manager? Is that what it is?
Yeah.
Representing
the
town? So the state mails me all these requests. So I did not get a request from Millis.
Look into that.
So probably what it is Millis has probably already got the capacity. They just don't need it. So they're going to probably pump it over to Medway.
So they're going to have to notify you anyhow at some point, right?
No. Only if they're going to increase the pumping at that station. In other words, they're probably already permitted.
If they're going to hold their permission.
To pump.
Well, it sounds like, according to John, it's a huge amount, and they're going to have to go before the state. I have no information about it, but he just mentioned that this evening. Can you just kind of look into that a little bit and see if...
Sure.
If you can see if there's any impact that's going to have on Medfield and our water supply.
Mm. Yeah, we'll be meeting with Charlie on the bridge anyway, so we can...
Yeah, we'll be meeting with Charlie, and it's... I know that if it's an interbasin transfer, they won't allow it. You know what I mean? It's, so I think Medway Wastewater Treatment Plant is in the Charles River, so they'll be putting it back in. So it's, and we don't draw, it's the aquifer we draw from. We don't draw from the river.
Right, right.
You know, that's...
Well, I was thinking Millis probably does the same thing.
Yeah, yeah. And Medway, Medway's probably pumping out of there, too.
Yeah.
I would think that Medway's already pumping out of the Charles.
Oh, if you just put that in the back of your mind, you just mentioned that this evening. I didn't have the information
yeah.
about it, but he just was concerned if there was going to be any impact to our aquifer, because it's the same one, whether we'd have less water to pump.
Yep.
Okay,
no
next.
Our problem isn't really that we have less water to pump. It's the state will not allow us to pump what we have available. They're restricting us. So it's really a state restriction, not a supply problem.
Well, whether the Medway Millis thing would take it down enough, I don't know all of them.
I think we have plenty of water. It's just the state won't let us use it.
So you don't think whatever Millis pumps and gives to Medway would impact us?
I don't think so, no.
Ken? Which one, Ken?
Sewer.
Okay. Do we do town garage yet?
It's just 11.
Yeah.
Town garage is way back, yeah.
Okay, sewer?
Sewer. 5.5% increase. Again, these budgets were voted by the Water and Sewer Board. This year here, you know, we look like we might be a little bit short this year in both water and sewer, so that reflects the 5.5% increase that we want to get some of the budget back.
Again, the salary on this, it's $1,024,736 currently, and the request is for $1,082,183. The wages are down about $6,000, so the increase is in the operations account. You had a major leak this year down on Causeway Street that cost, what, over $100,000 to fix?
Well, that was $130,000 repair.
The pipe under the bridge, right?
Yeah, the pipe under the bridge, yeah.
And they use the entire reserves, and that could be why you're running short on that budget.
Well, yeah, so. That's on the water department, yeah.
Yeah.
But it's, we, you know, it's line item by line item, too, that we're a little bit shy this year on some of the stuff. But
I guess we're not anticipating yet because we don't know what the total impact will be, but when the solar panel goes on board, there should be some savings in electricity there, I would think. That we might, as we go, as time goes by and we get a better idea, we should be able to lower the electricity budget.
It actually went up 4%.
Yeah, we went up $5,000 on that. Went up 4%. I asked Andrew about it, and he felt that way on it, too. Because remember, the year before, we had, we spent 168.
Yeah.
Okay. So they lowered it down to 125. With anticipation of the panels, and I knew the panels weren't going to go in that fast. I know construction, and so anyway, we're spending right now. We only went up 4% on it anyway, just $130,000. I spoke to Andrew about it, and he felt comfortable with the $130,000. Electricity's coming back down, but it did go up 21% before it started coming back down. So.
Well, the other thing, too, is I've noticed on these electricity bills, they lowered the kilowatt price of electricity, but they make it up in the demand charge. They really whack you on demand charges, and it's a very unfair system that I think should be looked at. But the other thing, too, is on the electricity, Bob McDonald mentioned something about because of the state requirement to get the was it phosphorus levels down to the new levels they've established? Will they drop it to 1 millimeter or something? Or what's the new
phosphorus?
Point one. That he's got to use more electricity to get the phosphorus out so he can comply with the levels.
Yeah, it increases the wasting rates because you increase the chemicals, the coagulators, mm-hmm. and to lock the phosphorus up in the sludge. therefore you pump more sludge, and, you know, it's a little waste increase, you know, you're producing more waste to get that number. He can get it. We did a pilot study down there, and they come up with the numbers for us, and we can get it on a steady basis at 0.1.
But it requires more electricity to do so.
It does. Yeah. It's expensive.
So is that why, because I just am confused, because when we went with the solar panels, it seemed to me it was like 60-something percent. They said we were going to have a savings on that.
37.
How much?
37%.
37%?
Yeah.
So right. that's not reflected. Is that because of this additional pumping that you have to do?
Without the solar panels, we spent, so far, in 2015, $168,652. So you're only appropriating 130. So that's part of the issue, 30, whatever it is, percent.
Oh, so the 125, you were way over. You spent way more than the 125 then.
Right.
Okay.
Way more. So we only went up 130.
So then probably fiscal year 18, probably we probably see even more reduction of that, hopefully, of the electrical costs.
Hopefully, yeah. Yep. Yeah.
Okay. Anything else? Ken, what's the special detail? Why do we have to have police down there?
Police?
Yeah, well, there's a $2,000 police special detail.
Well, no. If you, you know, if we're out doing sewer manholes, repairing sewer manholes, you have to have a detail.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, well, any construction, or if it's a...
We're not being attacked at the plant or anything.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And the last one was town garage.
Town garage, I thought we did.
Yeah, you get it. Yeah.
$203. Yeah, not too much to get concerned about there. Building maintenance.
Yeah, grounds maintenance and medical. $11,203. Any issue anyone has on that? Okay.
Yeah.
And then while we got you here, we had asked. Some issues with sidewalks, and I'll Pete, you had some questions on the cost of some of the sidewalks.
Ken, you were going to get us a ballpark figure as to what it would cost to do a sidewalk on Harding from the Dover line down to Hospital Road, I think, and so we just wanted to check on that figure with you.
Yeah, I haven't worked on particularly on Harding, but I have an estimate for East Main. Oh, East Main, just the survey is about $45,000. So, you know, you're going to go down. I know Mike came up with, he wanted to go just the shores, and I came up with, you know, take it all away, because what the heck, they're out there surveying, let them survey, you know. But there was $45,000 just for a survey. So, you can assume on Harding Street, it's a less distance, you know, but it's still an expensive thing. You're going to have to do survey first, and then you're going to have to find out, do we have enough room to put a sidewalk in? And you might have to even drill for some coring because of a ledge along the way. Mm. You know, you got to, and with the lease with the survey, we'll know if we own enough property to put a sidewalk in. Otherwise, you're going to get into takings. Or easements. Now, sometimes people don't get, you know, objectional to anything without, you know, if you ask for an easement and not a taking. So that there's a lot to be answered on the Harding Street. There's a lot to be done up there. And source of funds for survey is a good question.
What do they actually do in a survey? Just show what you need?
Well, you know, telephone poles. They show telephone poles that might have to be missing. You know, stone walls. They'll be shown on the plan, stone walls. Fire hydrant that has to be moved. You know, they pick all these things. They pick everything up that's going to be
Do they do borings for wetlands
and
or
they can
ledge
come up with how many trees are going to be cut.
Okay.
That kind of thing. So it's borings for ledge.
Ledge.
Harding Street's got ledge. Might be able to go to one of the sewer plants on that, because I know I did them out in the street on Harding Street, so you might be able to go there and see what they look like, you know. But and you know, I asked the school department what they wanted, because I think it's important to them, the sidewalks, and I think they met a comment, which we have done survey, and we have a plan.
Right.
Okay?
You can work on that.
I've got that plan. I don't know if anybody's seen the plan. I've got it with me, if anybody wants to look at it.
So you anticipate sometime in the spring underway?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's what, you get that one. I think they like Adam Street, obviously, because of the school. And,
The Dale Street one keeps coming up also. It's a short section from Charles Dale to Grove Street.
Yep, yep.
But you have probably about 850-year-old, 200-year-old pines that are on one side. I don't know if that road can be shifted off, because on the other side is just open cemetery land. So I don't know if you've had a chance to look up there.
There's a lot of trees on that one that got to go. I think that, we own some of them. I don't think we own all of them.
No.
I know that somebody, one of the contractors was looking to buy the house on the corner. I already spoke to him, and he said he would take the trees down for us, so, which is pretty good. But that's some of the trees. There's a lot of pine tree there.
There's a lot. There's 8 or 9 of them, and they're huge.
Yeah. I don't know if the people would like to get rid of them. I wouldn't want them around my house, because they always snap off the top or get hit with lightning and come on down, you know.
With them gone,
I just find them to be a dangerous tree.
Neighborhood, though.
Huh?
But with them gone, it would make a huge appearance difference in that neighborhood. I don't know whether the neighbors like it or not. You'd have to have a hearing of some kind anyhow, right?
You would have to have a hearing, not necessarily for a private tree, if they gave us permission.
The public
trees you're going to have a hearing for, yeah.
You'd have a chance to go to that.
And, you know, I don't know, it's a pretty short sidewalk. You know,
it's not long, it's like from here to the wall.
But it's a lot of trees.
Yeah.
It's a lot of trees.
But it breaks up. I mean, I can understand the argument, because everything coming from the Gatehouse Apartments, that all that neighborhood, Richard Road, Charles Dale, everything funnels that, because there's no sidewalks on West Street or 27 for those kids to go. So they're going to funnel all that way, and then they get up to that one section, and then there's none, and then it picks up at Grove Street, and then you can take it all the way to town. So it's a one missing gap, and that would probably service a lot of people.
Maybe.
Especially the whole apartment complex.
Well, I'm sure they're not walking to school, that's for sure.
No, but if they go uptown.
I mean, they go uptown.
You don't want them walking on 27.
Some of them, actually, I've seen a mother walking kids down Dale Street, crossing them at North Meadows, and then they can walk the rest of the way by themselves. But so when I walk down there, you'll see, not a lot, but there are a few that walk along there to get to school. Because
yeah.
Dale Street's pretty close for that.
Yeah. Anything else with that?
No, I think that was just the thing that I remember.
I had a couple of things, Ed, Ken, quickly on an update on those Green Street poles. These utility companies seem to be taking a long time getting the wires off. I think the latest email I saw is that Comcast is going to be there this week.
Good.
And then Verizon then has to follow.
I didn't get that email unless it came in late.
Well,
I talked to can't think of his name.
Franks.
Eversource.
Franks.
Jack Lopes.
Oh,
this
Jack.
Morning,
okay.
And then I talked to Franks too. After Jack Lopes gave me his number, and I didn't realize Evelyn had it, but so I called him, and he got back to me this afternoon, and he said they told him they would be there within a day or two. So they'll be there this week, Comcast. Then he gave me the number for Stephanie Lee to call her as soon as we get word that Comcast is off. Now, you said Verizon's the toughest one to get them to move.
They're both equally tough. I mean, I think Verizon, they're still on a pole down there in the corner of Cross Street, and, you know, it's just not Cross Street, the other one up across Curve Street. And to put on that pole, and the guy retired, you know what I mean? It's just, you know, chasing him down, you know, it's just crazy.
Yeah.
But the telephone's tough. I mean, they just, know, they're the only.
Well, why don't we call tomorrow and talk to her and see if maybe we can get her starting moving on it anyway, so.
Are your plowers concerned at all with Green Street coming down?
Well, we're not, certainly we're not pushing back. I mean, now the striping is, the striping's off because the poles are out there, and now you end up with short, narrow lanes that are painted. So, yeah, it's not a, you know, the guys can work around it, but it's still, it narrows the heck out of the road.
Yeah.
Really does.
It does, yeah.
We just maybe impress upon them the urgency of that of Green Street with just safety, because you got a potential storm.
Oh, it's definitely.
Yeah, I think she's aware of it, because she's been at these meetings when we've discussed it and said it was a top priority. You know, the question is, can she impress upon the people she has to deal with the importance of it, so.
I found her very, very agreeable and very.
I think she was too, yeah, yeah. It's how many departments she has to go through to get to it, so.
And the other, my other question, Ken, was on the north side of Green Street, and I know you've been very concerned. I think you're the ADA person in town as well. When they put the poles in, they put them right in the middle of the sidewalk.
Yeah, they kicked those back.
There's no way anyone in a wheelchair, anything, could get around them. But what I've noticed that you guys have done on some of them, I'll use the term an apron, I don't know what else, but you enlarge around that.
Yeah.
So that when you come, I know there's two on South Street that are like that.
Yeah.
Is that something that would be done on Green Street?
Yeah, we call them roundouts or something like that. But it's just, yeah, we did it down there because those poles were major poles to move. I think the wires came in three different directions on them, a lot of wires. So we just, you know, just did a roundout instead, just go around it.
But with the same thing.
We're not done down there, Richard, yet anyway. We still have to check everything down there. You know, next year, we still got 2 more inches of pavement that got to go on.
Yeah.
You know, so we'll be down there. So we'll check it out.
So that's something probably you look at with these roundouts?
Yeah, we can see something like that. Now, the plow went around the pole. It did get around it, but it I think he lifted his plow to get around it. You know what I mean? So
sometimes you have to go out onto the street.
Well, the plows are 5 feet, you know, so it's you're 5 feet of clearance. The ADA, I think, is 48 inches, you know what I mean? So it's big difference between the plow and the ADA.
Mm.
But we're not done down there, so we'll have to take a look at it again. Okay. But I think, you know, the poles are there, they're fine. We'll work around it.
My other question was, can you get me at some point, when the Green Street sidewalks went in, you said they were cement, because a future or a past, I guess a past Board of Selectmen set a policy of the downtown. What streets are in that downtown zone?
Yeah, I did get the email from you, and I think you got it pretty much. I think that's about right. I didn't want to write it back to you until I checked it, and I haven't had an opportunity to go out there and check. But I think what you have in your email is about right.
Okay.
I guess what are the sidewalks that are in the downtown then for purposes of?
Well, the areas, and a lot of these don't have cement, but I guess when they would be replaced. I have South Street from Main to Oak, Pleasant Street from Main to Oak, Miller Street, Upham Road, North Street from Main to Green Street from North Street to Brook or Lowell Mason, I'm not sure which, Cottage Street from North to Adams, James Avenue, Main Street from the Cemetery to Brook Street. We're in that zone.
Sure. The downtown zone.
A lot of those are not cement. Yeah. So when I take it, when they would be repaired, it would be cement.
Can you email out that list to the other two board members, too, so they'll have it?
Okay.
Anything else for Ken?
We did. Roland is applying for funds for the highway for the parking garage out here. Okay, we are trying to get it under economic development. It's a different pool of money. It doesn't go through the DOT. It's a different group of people. It certainly meets the criteria. And so, Roland, actually, I think this is a draft letter.
If you can get some information on what particular program, economic development program, then we can let our reps and senator know on that. So that would be
Let me see, identified funding program. Yeah, they consolidated 6 pharma programs. PWED, I can't say that one. I don't know what that is. Moore is one. Strap.
It's the mass development or something, isn't it?
Yeah. But I think they're calling it, it's, in municipalities, support economic development, job creation.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's what they do.
They used to want to be one called P-WED.
Yeah, P-WED's in there. They got P-WED.
That's been consolidated into, yeah.
So it's not through Mass DOT, so I think, yeah, we have to get the rep, we should copy the reps on this letter.
That was, there were like four purposes, and I thought that we qualified out for one, like economic development or something, or?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay.
Anything else for Ken?
I'm telling you, we need a railroad station, guys, if we want more money from the state, you know? You know, we can put one up just because the train doesn't stop, it's not our problem. I think it's worth 10 points on the applications.
Okay, thank you, sir.
All right, great.
Thanks, Ken.
Under old business, we have, I guess, licenses or permits. St. Edward's Parish requests a one-day liquor license to fund a fundraiser they're having on January the 30th in the parish hall from 6 to 8 p.m.
Second.
All in favor?
Yep.
Aye. We have old business, the selectman calendar, and everybody get a copy of that?
Not with me.
We have listed for next meeting, the 26th, budget review, school committee, field upgrade committee. Have they come in with a final price yet, do you know?
If, no, I don't, they haven't, but I, my understanding is it's gone up quite a bit, so it's not gonna be good news.
And the warrant for the annual town meeting closes at the end of that meeting. Is there anything else, Peter, Mark, you want for the 26th?
Evelyn had, yeah.
Under that paper, you'll see an agenda for next week, next meeting. That's when we have the EPA and the stormwater. So that's all we're doing.
Good.
Oh, okay.
Because they're gonna take it out in half.
But that, yeah, but.
I think Jay should be at that one.
Unfortunately, I have a prior commitment.
Sure.
The, you take good notes. The warrant closes, so they need to vote to close the warrant. But so I, if you, please review that list again. If you don't want any of those articles on, let me know. If you wanna add anything that isn't in there. For example, you know, do we wanna put an article in for design funds for Main Street sidewalk?
Main Street, yeah.
Or do you wanna try to take that out of chapter 90 money?
Can just to follow up with that, I know in years past, every time a street light went in, went to town meeting, is that still true or not?
Street light?
Yeah.
No, we never, we went to town, the only time we've gone to town meeting was to, when we reduced the budget to take out street lights, but that was 1981.
Years back, every time a street light came in, it actually was an article of town meeting. And we go back in the 50s and 60s and actual articles, so we don't have to worry about that.
No.
Because my question was, if it was, I would add that. I had a resident concerned about the darkness of Frary and Upham area of where that traffic island is requesting one. So I'll bring that up at a later time.
I'm concerned about the darkness in front of the FAF Center driveway. I think that's a safety issue.
Okay, maybe we can add that.
It's interesting, since 1982, when we took out, I believe it was 25% of the streetlights, we've only put one back in.
Yeah.
And that's, we've held that budget, you know, that's the way you really keep the budget, so you have to be careful you don't unleash a flood of requests.
I agree, but the policy was, it would either be where an intersection is or, quote, a dangerous safety road.
It was, you know, a bad curve, a dangerous intersection, or a highly traveled road.
Right.
So with the three.
I mean, the traffic on that Upham Road is a whole other issue. The parking is, now it's coming up right around the corner under Frary. You can barely get by one car with snowbanks in the winter. It's we need to put this on the agenda at some point to look at that, but that's for future time.
There was a presentation at the Energy Committee by Fred Davis last week. And he's got a proposal to replace, well, to buy all of the the streetlights in the town and replace them with LEDs, and it saves tens of thousands. I mean, the budget's only $40,000 a year or something, but his proposal's going to save quite a bit of that, tens of thousands a year.
Yeah, the concern I have with that is we then assume the maintenance responsibility.
He's figured that in. You know, I mean, you get a maintenance contract with somebody. And
But, you know, every time someone is an accident, someone hits a pole and the light has to be replaced, there's a charge for it. Every time you get a storm and you get lights out, they then call the town instead of the utility to get the light replaced. So if you're not careful, you can easily use up the savings on your maintenance costs. If you had to buy a truck with a cherry picker on it, that could easily wipe out your savings.
One of those. The fire department has one of those, but I would think that we would just have a maintenance contract. The city of Newton, for instance, they don't fix their own traffic.
They have thousands of lights. We have about 400. You know, they can
traffic signals. They just have a contract with somebody to keep the traffic signals.
We do that. I believe we do that for traffic signals, but not for streetlights. Yeah. Streetlights gets to be a different can of worms. A few years ago, there were a lot of towns that were jumping on buying their own streetlights, and they were contracting with a municipal light utility in a town north of Boston, and the guy was getting a commission on every client he signed up for. I believe he ended up going to jail, and all the towns that thought they had really cheap maintenance contracts ended up having no contract, and it didn't turn out to be the good deal it seemed to be. So while I generally like the idea, I would rather see the utilities provide LED lights at a savings and have them retain the maintenance costs than have the town take on responsibility for which we could end up spending a lot more money.
Well, it strikes me as a good idea. Westwood just got a grant from the state, $240,000, to replace their street lights with LEDs. You get a better light from it, among other things, which I think it would improve the look of the town.
Yeah.
Be safer.
You're right, though. I don't know. Everyone, you know, could be too white, the LED lights. Some of them are pretty bright. Then people would complain. I can see us replacing them all, and then people saying now the lights are too bright, right? And then
you just
complain.
It's a change. Yeah. When we converted to the sodium lights, we had a lot of complaints about they were too pink.
Yeah, yeah.
And they were bright and they showed more light. So, but people got used to it. Yeah.
They have their own. Is that,
they're buying their own. And they're buying their street lights, and a lot of towns are, because it's a savings.
Under old business, also we motion to accept the January 5 minutes. Is there any corrections or deletions you had on that, Mark?
No.
I had one. You had listed the house as 13 Pleasant Street. It's actually 13 South Street.
Oh, yeah.
Anything you had on that?
No. Second?
Motion. So moved.
And all in favor?
Yep.
And anything else to come before the board? Hi, Kevin.
Just had a resignation of the hospital committee, so.
Which devastated me reading that.
That's very sad. Because Ken Richard is just, he's very knowledgeable.
He's very knowledgeable. He's very common sense. I just had the highest regard for his role in that committee. And was looking to see if there's anything we could do to persuade him otherwise.
I don't know. His resignation letter was pretty well thought out, I thought.
I exchanged emails with him, and he didn't seem inclined to rethink it.
And I know a number of the members committee did chat with him personally to try to see if they could change his mind or something like that. So, yeah, I think he's very definitive on how he felt.
That's a huge loss for this town. Okay, anything else?
Motion to adjourn. Thank you.